Hi everyone, my name is Tom Barry and I'm the Assistant Director of Education at the Cradle of Aviation Museum in Garden City. And we were going to come out to Sachem Public Library to do a program about the Golden Age of Flight. And it was going to be a wonderful program. We were going to learn, we were going to laugh, we were going to schmooze. It was going to be fantastic. Obviously, we could not do that. So we're going to do a virtual program for you. And instead of just doing a program where we talk about something, maybe you learn a fun fact or two, something like that, we're going to actually do a program where we teach you how to use a certain software so that you can then take that information and run with it. We're going to show you how to use a planetarium software, a desktop planetarium software called Stellarium. Now, Stellarium is free. It's open source. You don't have to really sign anything to use it. Essentially, you just have to say, hey, I'm not going to sell this to somebody else. It's one of the most powerful and easy to use planetarium softwares out there that you can get for free. So we're going to take you through the basics in this program. And then the next program that we're going to do, we're going to do a little bit of a deeper dive into some of the functionality of the software. But we're going to start with the basics. And to get this wonderful software, all you have to do is go to the website stellarium.org. So stellarium.org. And when you do that, you will come to this fine page here. And then you can just pick whatever operating system you're using. Linux, are you using Macs, are you using Windows? You can even do a web-based version of Stellarium. That's that second to last button at the top over there that says Stellarium Web. You click that and it'll bring you to a website which has the very basic functionality of Stellarium. But you can use that if you want, but we're going to actually use the software that you can download. So you just double-click on whatever operating system you're using, you download it, and you follow the instructions to install the software. So I'll let you do that now. I'll just kind of sit here waiting for you to do that. Or you can hit pause and do that if you want. Or you can just watch this and do it later, you know. So, stellarium.org. You download it, you install it, you double click on the icon that will bring up the software. And when you do that, you should have a screen that looks like this, except for me down here in the corner. It'll look a little different for you because I'll be gone. In fact, you know what? I'm kind of self-conscious, so I'm going to turn myself off. Bye. And we are just left with the software. So when you open up the software, you will see a landscape around you. Now, this landscape is a beautiful little area in France. You can change landscapes, but the landscape is not unique to the location at which you find yourself. So if this landscape here in France, it's going to be the same landscape if I go to New York City or if I go to Moscow. Wherever I am, this landscape is the same. You can change it, but it's not connected to the location you're at, is what I'm trying to say. Now, today, when we go through all the stuff that we're going to go through, we're going to concentrate on this bottom row here of buttons. We're going to concentrate on all those. So, obviously, to start out, we're going to go to these other set of buttons over here because I just want to show you one thing. These are the buttons we're going to be going through for the deeper dive, but I want you to just take a look at the location window. That's the very top button in that side menu. And if you bring your cursor over to the left side of your screen, that menu should just pop out for you. If you open up location window, you'll get this window that opens up. And it's a map of the Earth. There's a little red arrow in there that's pointing to where Stellarium is now. Stellarium will try to figure out where you are. So if you have your location services enabled, it should be able to pick out about where you are. Now, I'm in New York City. So when my Stellarium opened up for the first time, it had me in New York City. But you are not in New York City, are you? No. You are out on the island, and Sachem Public Library is located in Holbrook. So what I'm going to do is, in this little search bar here, I'm going to type in Holbrook, And look at that up there, Holbrook, United States of America. So we click on that, and we are now in Holbrook. The longitude and latitude changed ever so slightly to put us in Holbrook. So I'm going to close out this window. And now you are in your location. Now, here's the really, really cool part, and I'm actually going to bring up my webcam again. You can go wherever you want in the world with this. Do you want to see what the stars look like in Sydney, Australia? Do you want to see what the stars look like in the middle of Africa? You can do that with this software, and it will be accurate. It's amazing. But we're going to start off where you are. We're going to start off in Holbrook. All right, so it doesn't look a whole lot different, does it? We just have our blue sky. If you're watching this at night, you probably notice that your sky that you see is different than mine. I'm recording this at 12:30 in the afternoon. If you're doing this at 11 o'clock at night, it'll be showing you the night sky. The default is to go to the time that you are at. Okay? So if you see something different, if you see stars up in the sky, that's why. Now, let's take a look down here. I'm going to start on the left side of this bottom menu here. All right, and see how it says Earth, Holbrook, 39 meters up from sea level. All right, the first button that you have has kind of a set of lines. And what that does, it just creates the lines for the 88 modern constellations. All right, now a constellation isn't a pattern of stars in the sky. A constellation is technically an area of the sky. And anything that's inside of that area is considered to be in that constellation. But to identify the constellations, to locate them using the naked eye, we still use these patterns. So Stellarium has the lines for the constellations. Now, to move around the sky in Stellarium, all you do is left-click your mouse and drag. So you see all of these different constellation lines there. You might recognize a few of them. For example, there's Orion up there. It doesn't matter that we have the blue sky going on there. The stars are still out during the day. You just can't see them because of the sun. The sun's light scattering in our atmosphere. So that first button is constellation lines. The next button is constellation names. So we're facing north right here. There's a little N down there at the bottom of the screen. It might be a little difficult for you to see, but there's a little N down there. And right above it is Ursa Minor. And to the right of Ursa Minor right now is Ursa Major. These are the great and little bears. Ursa Major, Ursa Minor. So all of the constellations that are out there, they can be labeled. And that's what that second button is. Moving on to our third button. This is the fun one. Constellation Art. You click it. And these buttons, they're like toggles. You click them on, you click them off. All right? So we have constellation artwork that's associated with these constellations. Again, these are the modern constellations, and most of the northern constellations, they are coming to us from the Greek tradition. So you will find constellations that have names associated with Greek mythological characters, Gemini the twins, Orion the hunter, things like that, Taurus the bull, Cetus the sea monster. So you'll find different characters from Greek mythology in here. It's not solely Greek mythology in there. There are other constellations that were made later or identified later, but the majority of them do come to us from the Greek tradition in the Northern Hemisphere here. Southern Hemisphere, that's a different story. But Sachem isn't in the Southern Hemisphere, is it? No. So we have the different constellation pictures that you can toggle on and off. So that's what we have to start. I'm going to toggle all of them off now. And I'm actually going to come back to you as well. So when we're talking about the location of stars and objects in the sky, we use something that's similar to latitude and longitude here on Earth. We have different grids that we can use. One of them, it's essentially taking the Earth's grid of latitude and longitude and kind of pushing that out into space. That's one grid that we use. And then there's another one that's kind of unique to your location. So in the first grid that I'm going to show you, which is that next button, there we go, that equatorial grid, that's the Earth's latitude and longitude pushed out into space, but we don't call it latitude and longitude space. We call it right ascension and declination for space. All right. So that's the Earth's grid system pushed out into space. You'll notice that they all meet at that point right there. Well, that point right there is the point that would be right above the North Pole if you were up there. So that is where one of the most important stars in our sky is located. It's right at the edge of the handle of the Little Dipper, and it's called the North Star. So if I bring up the constellation lines, you'll see that the last spot in the Little Dipper there, it's right there at that 90 degree mark, all right? The zenith of what your sky would be if you were at the North Pole. So that's one coordinate system. The other one is unique to you where you are, the alt-azimuth system grid, and this one is more unique to you. So the zenith of the sky is right above your head wherever you are. All right, this is also called the horizontal grid right here, horizontal coordinates. So, because it has to do with the horizon being 0 degrees. So, those are your next two things here. Now, I want you to notice something. You are in Holbrook, I'm in New York City. We're about the same latitude at two places. I'm going to go back to that location window. And your latitude in Holbrook is just above 40 degrees latitude. All right. Well, the North Star, which is in the Little Dipper right there, it's right there in the handle. Now, each of these lines here is 5 degrees. So, 5 degrees, 10 degrees. 15 degrees, 20 degrees, 25 degrees, 30 degrees, 35 degrees, 40 degrees, and just a little above is where the North Star is there. So you can use that North Star to find your latitude. If you were at the North Pole, that North Star would be right above your head, 90 degrees up from the horizon, or 90 degrees up from you, up there, right, straight up. So that's kind of helpful. If you're doing something locally, if you know someone says Jupiter will be 10 degrees above the horizon at your location, this is the type of system that you would use to do that. All right. So those are the grids. Now we're getting into the fun stuff. I'm going to take this off here. Now the next button is your landscape, your ground. You can turn it on or off. So let's say that you want to look at something that's below the horizon. Well, you can get rid of the horizon and you can look down at things. Now, again, right now we're just looking at a blue sky, so it's not much to see down there. This next button, it turns on and off your cardinal points. So your north, south, east, west turns them on and off. And this is the button, atmosphere. So if you turn off the atmosphere, you'll be able to see the stars that are out during the day, kind of like astronauts in space. You can still see stars out even when the sun is shining on you in space because you don't have that atmosphere scattering that light, making it all blocked for you. So if we turn off the atmosphere, no matter what time of day, you can see the stars. Now let's take a look at some of the constellations that we saw before. But now we're going to see those constellations, the lines, the artwork laid over the stars. So if we bring up the lines here, there's the Little Dipper right there. There's the Big Dipper over there. You see how the lines line up with the stars. If we bring up the names, Ursa Major, Ursa Minor, Cepheus is over there, Draco's in the middle, and the artwork. Now we're starting to see how all of this works together. So we have the lines, we have the artwork to kind of give us a little more of an indication of what these lines are supposed to look like or what they represent anyway, because some of them don't look anything like what they're supposed to. But we're seeing it all kind of work together now. So anytime during the day and night, if you turn off the atmosphere, you will be able to see the stars. So that's that. I'm going to take out these lines again. There we go. So that's the atmosphere button. Next, deep sky objects. And this is just fun stuff. So we have different objects here that you can click on. Now again, to move the screen, all I'm doing is left clicking and dragging. So you can go all throughout the sky, and let's say I want to take a look at the Andromeda Galaxy. You click on it, and when you click on the Andromeda Galaxy, a lot of information about that galaxy comes up. Its magnitude, how bright it is, where it's located in the sky, its distance, all kinds of great stuff. But you want to see it, don't you? So if you just click that little forward slash on your keyboard, it will zoom in on the Andromeda Galaxy. There it is. Now, a lot of these pictures that are used for these deep space objects are taken from the Hubble Space Telescope. So it's the information from Hubble that was imported into Stellarium, and now it's there for you. To zoom back out, you just hit the backslash on your computer, and you will be zoomed out again. So you can do that with any deep space object that is labeled here, the different clusters, the nebulae, all that kind of good stuff. It's a really cool feature of Stellarium, and there is no shortage of deep space objects for you to look at. It's really fun stuff. All right. Oh, look at that. There's the moon. That's not a deep space object. That's a solar system object. But again, you click on it. It's selected. All the information for it comes up. Its location, its magnitude, how much of it is illuminated right now. But then you can also zoom in on the moon. And this stuff is accurate. That is the phase of the moon that it is in right now, the time that I'm looking at it. It will be accurate for you as well. So cool. So you zoom in by hitting the forward slash. You zoom out by hitting the backslash. All right. So we're going to deselect our deep space objects. Planets. So different planets will be out in the sky at different times of day or night. It's more difficult, obviously, to see planets during the day because, you know, the sun and its light scattering in the atmosphere. But we took out our atmosphere, so we can see the planets. And there's Venus up there, up in the sky. So what we can do is we can click on it. Again, left click on it. That selects it. Forward slash zooms in. Now, Venus has phases because it's what we call an inferior planet. It's closer to the sun than the Earth. So it has its different phases. So it's kind of like a crescent Venus right now up in the sky. But that's Venus there. Again, you have its magnitude, its distance, which is totally cool, how much of it is illuminated. And then again, to zoom out, you click out. So when you go to whatever time you're going to, when you see the planets that are out there, they will be where they are in the sky at that time. Now, on this, it's easier to see things, much easier to see things, because you can adjust the size of different objects based upon their magnitude, so you can see them more easily. And on Long Island, we have quite a bit of light pollution, so things won't look quite like they do up in the sky. Now, with Stellarium, though, you can adjust for that. You can adjust for light pollution, so you can make it actually match up with your sky and make it look like what you would actually see in your sky. And that will be in our next episode of this tutorial for Stellarium. So we're going to deselect Venus, and to deselect an object, all you do is right click. This is so easy. To select, you left click, you zoom in by hitting forward slash, you zoom out by hitting backslash, you deselect by right click. Bada bing, bada boom, done. Next button. So we did the planets there. So this one here, you're not really going to be using a whole lot, switching between different mounts So kind of like a telescope mounts. There are different types of mounts. There's no real reason for you to use it if you're just using this for naked eye viewing. So don't worry about that button too much. Again, with this one here, center on the selected object. If you select an object and you zoom in, it's going to center on that object anyway. So you don't really need to use this button so much either. Okay. This next one is night mode. That's kind of interesting. So let's say you have this on a laptop or a tablet type computer that you can take outside and you want to use it outside in the field. You click night mode and it changes everything to this red hue. You see, red does not interfere with your night vision. So by turning on night mode, you can go out, look at your screen, and then look up, and you're going to be able to see everything. If you're looking at a screen that has a bunch of white light coming at you, when you look up, you're going to have a little night blindness. You're not going to be able to see everything for a while. And it takes about 8 minutes for the human eye to adjust to the dark. So by having night mode, you can keep your eyes adjusted to the dark while still using the software outside. That's a really cool and a really helpful button to have. This next one, I'm not going to click. It's full screen mode. I recommend using it, but if I use full screen mode with this broadcasting software that I'm using now, this recording software, it goes away and it doesn't show up. So I'm not going to use full screen mode, but you can. Please feel free. Use it. Love it. Moving on. Show exoplanets. So we have discovered thousands of exoplanets. So this shows you where they are. So if you click on it, a bunch of little tiny dots will show up on the screen. I'm going to kind of zoom in on an area here. A bunch of little teeny tiny dots. And these are exoplanet systems that we have found. So you can kind of zoom in. It'll zoom in on the star that they're going around. All right, so you can actually see all these markings up in the sky. And again, when you click on it, zooming in doesn't really make too much of a difference because you're just kind of looking at the system that it's in. So you're not going to see planets going around. But you can see where the planetary systems are up in the sky, which is kind of cool. So all those little green circles that you're seeing up there, some of them are kind of tough to see, but those are different planetary systems. All right, so I'm going to zoom back out. There we go. We're going to deselect by right-clicking. So exoplanets. Meteor showers, you can toggle them on and off. Here's the thing, though. So you can toggle on and off the meteor showers. It's great. It's fun to look at. But if you have the atmosphere turned off, like I do now, you're not going to be able to see the meteor showers. And the reason why is pretty cool. The reason why we have meteor showers is because of our atmosphere. Meteoroids out in space, as they get close to the Earth, the gravity's pulling them down. They travel through our atmosphere. And as they're burning up in the atmosphere, we see them. And we see the beautiful meteor that they create. Well, if we don't have an atmosphere, that doesn't happen. So if you want to see a meteor shower in Stellarium, you need to have the atmosphere selected and you need to be late at night because you don't really see meteors so much during the day, unless it's a big one, in which case a lot of people will be seeing that. All right. So that's seeing meteor showers in Stellarium. If you want to see meteor showers in real life, this next button here is pretty handy. You can do a search for meteor showers between different dates. So these are all the meteor showers between January 1st, 2020 and December 31st, 2020. And it shows you all the different meteor showers that happen between those times. And over here, the peak, that's the peak date. And this shows you the zenith hourly rate. So how many meteors at the peak of the meteor shower you can expect to see. And the most consistent meteor shower probably is the Perseid meteor shower in August. You can see upwards of 100 meteors. Now, light pollution can get in the way. But you can still see a good number of meteors per hour with the Perseid meteor showers. So that gives you the different meteor showers that you can see in real life, IRL. That's a really cool button. Moving on, satellite hints. So it gives you the approximate location of different satellites going through the sky, including the International Space Station. I'm just looking to see if anything's above the horizon right now. That's moving along. So you'll see them as moving points of light, which is kind of what they look like at night too. The International Space Station is one of the easiest to see. If you know that it's coming and you know where to look, once you spot it, you can't mistake it really for anything else. It kind of looks like an airplane, but it doesn't have any of those blinking lights. So the satellite hints, it helps you out with where satellites will be at certain times. For satellites, if you want to see the International Space Station, I wouldn't recommend using Stellarium. What I would recommend using is an app called ISS Spotter. It's free. You can download it. You put in your location, and it'll give you over the next 10 days all the different times that the International Space Station will be flying over your location. I recommend that using that much more than using Stellarium. All right. So I showed you all those buttons for Stellarium, the basics, but we are still at my now. If I turn up the atmosphere, yeah, the moon is out, sure, but we're still at now. I want to get to tonight. I want to see what the stars will look like tonight. So that's where these next sets of buttons come in. We have this first button over here. This decreases time. So at default, the time will be going one second per second. So if we want to stop time or slow it down, we hit that backwards button once, and it'll stop you. Then we can start going backwards in time. And each time you click that button, you're going to be going faster and faster back in time. Now to stop it, you just hit the play button, which is the next button across. That will bring you back to 1 second per second. If you want to just pause time where you are, you hit the play button, the pause sign comes up, and you were paused at that time. Now, let's say that I went too far back in time or too far forward in time. For example, the next button, you can move forward. Oh, I'm sorry, wrong button. The next button puts you back to your default time, and Stellarium defaults you to the time you are at, the time that's on your computer. So if you go too far back in time or too far ahead in time with the next button we're going to look at, and you want to get back to now, you hit the button that's just to the right of the play button or the pause button, and that will bring you back to now. And if you want to keep going 1 second per second, you stop, pause, and you hit play, and it will keep you going. Now, notice how the last time I hit that button, it stayed lit. That's because when I hit play and then hit the return to now button, I'm going at 1 second per second in real time. So it's showing me right now that we are at now. It's like Spaceballs. Everything that's happening now is happening now. What happened to then? We passed it. When? Just now. The jokes never will get better, by the way. That's just my thing. Bad jokes, it's my thing. All right, so we're playing at 1 second per second, real time. We are at now. Let's say I wanted to speed up time. I want to go to tonight. I just hit the fast forward button. Now we're going a little bit faster. And again, each time you hit it, you go faster. You see it in the moon right there. I find that hitting it three times really gives you a nice progression of the sky. So you see the sun going down in the west over there. And as the sun sets, again, to move the screen to pan around, I'm just left clicking and dragging. The sun is setting, and now the stars will begin to come out. So this is tonight's sky, at least it is for me. Now I'm going to hit pause because now it's nice and dark, And it looks like we are at 10, 11, and 46, 47 seconds for tonight, my tonight, which is June 26th when I'm recording this. So now that we're looking at tonight's sky, we can again bring up the constellations and we can see what's out there. So after the sun sets, just after, the Great Bear, Ursa Major, is going to be in the northwestern sky. There's northwest labeled right over there. All right, so the Great Bear is coming down from its highest point in the sky. The North Star is right where we left it. It's always in the northern sky. King Cepheus, he switched sides from where we were when we first looked at the sky. There's Leo the Lion, Virgo, Corvus the Crow, Libra, Scorpius, Sagittarius. And look over there. There's Jupiter and Saturn rising up in the sky. So you can make it for whatever night you want it to be. For example, why don't I make it? This is a little bit of a deeper dive, but I'm going to make it for July 25th. Why not? So on July 25th, Jupiter and Saturn, they're a little bit higher up in the sky at that time of night. Again, though, you can click on them, /, to zoom in. Now, some objects you can zoom in twice on, three times on. They will keep getting closer and closer because Jupiter has many moons going around it. So it kind of gives you the option, hey, do you want to take a look at one of those moons, something like that? But you can zoom in on it. And again, it gives you all that wonderful information about Jupiter. You can click on Io, one of Jupiter's moons, and you can zoom in on that if you like even. So all these different objects that you can zoom in on just by selecting them and hitting that // button. Then you can zoom out again. And it takes a while sometimes to do it because you have to zoom out through different levels. But there we are again. And to deselect, all you do is right-click. Now, I'm going to hit that fast-forward button again. I'm going to take out all of our artwork. I'm going to take off the meteor showers. We're going to face east. Oh, look at that. There's Mars rising up in the sky. Now our atmosphere is on. So as the sun gets closer to rising, we're going to notice its light starting to scatter in our atmosphere. And over in the northeast, because it's summer, the sun will rise. And I'm going to hit play to stop it, or to make it go 1 second per second. And that is your basic introduction. One thing that I want to show you now from our next post that we're going to do is just that date and time window that I kind of brought up, where I brought myself from June when I'm recording this to July. With this date and time window, you can go to any date, past, present, future, any time, past, present, future, and you can see what the sky looked like. One of my favorite things to do is to go to the exact date and time that somebody was born, and you can show them exactly what the stars looked like, exactly what the moon looked like on the date and time they were born. You can either type it in, or you can use the up and down arrows to adjust the date over here, or you can adjust the time over here the same way. You can either select it and type it in, or use the arrows. You can also use the Julian day. That really is not something that you're going to need to concern yourself with. We'll get into that in the next one, what it means. But you have your Julian date over here and your modified Julian date over here. We'll get into that later. Really, you're not going to use it. You can stick with the date and time over here. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that is your Stellarium overview, at least the very basics of it. Next time we talk, tomorrow I think it's going to be, I'm going to go through some of the deeper things that you can do, because you can bring up different sky cultures from all around the world. You can adjust for light pollution. You can adjust the magnitude of stars to make them more or less visible on your screen. There, you can run scripts to show lunar eclipses, do a solar system tour. There are so many things that you can do. Today, we literally just scratched the surface of Stellarium. So, I will see you next time with part two. Until then, I hope you have a wonderful day, and I hope that you look up. It's a beautiful universe. Take care.